thing that's going on. Shortly after the order's given to commence fire, we still have somewhat of our ranks deployed around the south end of the village. Remember that one company of 3rd who've set up? They are now behind the 1st. These men are getting so excited that they tell us under testimony they begin shooting over and through the ranks of the 1st. Scott Anthony realizes suddenly he's getting fired from behind, and he starts mobilizing his men. His men are marching in perfectly good order to move up the creek. They actually cross the creek and start moving north. When many of the 3rd see them moving, they think they're going after the Indians, and they start taking off after the Indians. At that point, all command and control goes out the window. It ceases being a military operation and really just becomes targets of opportunity. The 1st are moving to the side. You've got the 3rd pitching into the people. You've got artillery flying over there. Where are the people going? Anybody
creek
remember
bed.
That from the book?
Creek bed.
Creek bed. Up around probably the 1st of which is about 2 miles away, there's a series of furrows in that soft sandy creek bed. It's those furrows carved out by hundreds of years of running water, of motion, of water, that people are climbing into, and they're actually clawing at the sides to get under that bank, to get out of the way of the exploding ordnance and the bullets, and they know no man's going to take a horse. Are you going to take your horse into that pit? No. Some are saying yes, okay. Don't get around this guy in combat. They're seeking the shelter of these pits, and the diaries or the accounts, the oral histories tell us that there were at least 3 of them. And many of the survivors get into these pits. And that's where the soldiers chase them up. The inexperience of the 3rd really is shown up here at these pits. That's when the men start getting close and looking over. And that's when the 3rd takes most of its casualties. 9 to 10 killed up right up to the north.